So welcome, Vaughn Smith. Welcome to Romania. I have a difficulty at the beginning of our conversation. I don't know how to present you. Are you a war correspondent, a journalist, a businessman, an entrepreneur, or how you were a few weeks, years ago, you were described in a story by Daily Beast as an eccentric, rich British guy?
Well, I mean, it's... I'm not sure that I'm all of those things. I think I'm probably some of those things. I don't think I'm very rich. If I were to be described at all as eccentric, I would consider that the greatest compliment.
Really?
I think eccentric people are a gift to humankind, and so I would like to be one. No, I run a restaurant. I think the thing I'm most proud of and most interested in is I run something called the Frontline Club in London, which came out of being a freelance video journalist and running a video journalist agency. But I'm also a farmer as well. I like farming, and that ties into the restaurant, so I'll bring food from my farm to the restaurant. But I particularly identify myself with freelance journalism.
What is Frontline? Because in Romania it's quite hard to understand this concept. A club for journalists who are doing freelancing. It's pretty weird.
Well, it's a bit more than that. Interestingly, that my origins were, I was a soldier and I left the army and I got together with some really interesting people, went off to Afghanistan because it was an adventure, and filmed, and found that I could sell the material, we could sell the material to the news organizations, the BBC, CNN, and people like that. And it was like a ticket to travel the world. A ticket for adventure, and we thought we could make a living. We didn't really make a great living, but the adventure was worth it. It was fantastic. And also, to be close to what's happening in the world, to be close to the things that are changing the lives of us all. And it was a very interesting time when we started. The Berlin Wall fell down, and we came to your country here. We came here and filmed here, and during your, well, coup d'etat revolution, whatever you like to call it. I think it's probably, we thought at the end it was probably a coup d'etat. But it was, you know, these things are incredible to witness and be at. I can't describe the engagement and satisfaction of knowing what's going on.
Just to stop a little bit, because it sounds interesting. British man who is thinking that 1989 events in Romania were a coup d'etat, not a revolution. Why do you think that?
Well, when we first came, it looked like a revolution. I think as journalists, I'm sure you'd agree, we should sometimes just check whether these things that look this way really are. I guess that's our job. But it was pretty clear after a while. Mostly by the time we were leaving here, there was quite a lot to suggest that it was a coup d'etat and that it was somehow an organized revolution. But it was quite clear that most people thought it was a revolution. But I think people had been perhaps used a little bit. And certainly the stories that came, you know, a year after, you know, with the miners and all these other things, again, I think it was pretty clear then to the international media that it was a coup d'etat.
You choose in your younghood to be a grenadier officer. From where this attraction to war? Because it's an attraction to war. From where do you get this?
Well, when I was a young man, I think this is quite common to a lot of young men. People want adventure, they want to kind of travel. And I think that I was brought up in a country, my father was a soldier, my grandfather was a soldier. So I came from an army family. And in Britain, it was an Indian army family because, of course, the British Empire, India was part of the British Empire. And that's where I sort of come from. And I live in a house and there are paintings of my ancestors on the walls and things like that. And so consequently, I was always going to join the army. I mean, it was kind of, you know, I'd been set on that course and it was a sort of cultural kind of thing. But actually, I found the army slightly constrictive. And when I left, I couldn't wait to go and travel and film and do things like that. But look, I'm going to go back to a question you asked a little bit earlier, and I apologize. But the Frontline Club, it is about freelance independent journalism. Well, it's really about independent journalism, but Chinese journalists would describe themselves as independent. This is a catch-all situation. I think we're all on a scale. We're all somewhere on the level of independence. I just think the most independent are people who often fund their own work, people who will be really the freest part of the free press is the freelance journalist, the person who's not going to have their work necessarily determined or packaged by an editor or someone else who may not have been there. It happens time and time again in journalism that a newspaper will have a political view or a political a cant of some sort. As a freelance, you don't have to necessarily subscribe to that. You can choose the newspaper, you can choose the television program, and so it is a great freedom in journalism to be independent, but it's also very difficult to make it commercially.
Mm-hmm. But what's from your personal experience, how important is the freedom degree in, let's say, the mainstream media, the established TV stations, newspapers? And I'm asking you about UK, of course, because probably you are more familiar with that.
I think we have a relatively good press in the UK. I don't think it's good as people from abroad think it is. We have our problems in the UK. Again, I think we're all on a scale. None of us are where we'd like to be. And in Britain, we have some very good things. I mean, we have a press that has been apparently free, or free to the extent it is, for a long time. We have a culture a group, a sort of intellectual groups, quite a lot of them in Britain, who sort of keep us on a road, I think, because, you know, people will start complaining if we deviate too far. Nevertheless, I think there's also something in journalism. You can... And this is very common in Western journalists, in journalists from, say America or say North Europe, where we'll go and do a story, but we are still approaching it with a sort of cultural perspective. It's not truly independent. It's not truly without bias. There's still cultural appreciations that go into it that sort of inform the way we do our stories. So, you know, I think I'm quite critical of British journalism. I think the British journalists, the main problem for me in journalism as a whole is that journalism, certainly in my country, isn't self-critical. We're very good at criticising everybody else, but we're not very good at looking at ourselves and seeing whether we really match, you know, the standard that we claim to do. And also the other thing is the vehicle for most journalism in the world, almost all of it, is commercial. Now, that's all fine, but, you know, the requirements of a business are always going to be different on some level to the requirements of inquiry. And so I think we would be better in Britain if we had a few more models for delivering journalism, and maybe we will develop them.
We were here quite affected by the fact that by the way in which the British media reported the beginning of 2014 the liberalization of the work market for Romanians and Bulgarians. Yeah. It was a problem. Can you explain us why the big tabloids are so badly reporting about that, falsely, I would say?
You're completely right. I mean, the reporting was absurd. In fact, the funniest thing was you had all these senior British reporters at the airport on the first flight in after this date, and there was one single Romanian. All the others had visas because they were doctors or they were this or they were that. And
why is this happening?
So yes, no, I can answer that. You said why. And
what's the reason behind it?
One of the problems we have in journalism generally is the economic model seems to be collapsing with the internet. The advertising revenues that we're so dependent on aren't really there on the internet. So therefore, what's happening is news organizations aren't getting the same money. And so what we call the tabloid press, which is, you know, we call them tabloid for many reasons, but one of them is they tend to go for slightly smaller newspapers that are more accessible, more readable. Perhaps subscribe to a lower denominator in terms of, you know, they try and be very populist. But I think it's not to say that all their journalism is bad. Sometimes their journalism, I think, is absolutely extraordinary, and they can be very courageous in their journalism, and they can be very powerful when they've got the right story. But there is a tendency to try to get, you know, headlines that attract. In this instance, I think also they're informed politically. And there's an increasing concern in Britain, which troubles me, over worries about immigration. And also, we suffer in Britain from a certain conceit. a certain idea that our country is so wonderful that everybody must want to come, which is, of course, patently absurd, because, you know, apart from anything else, our weather isn't very good. You've got much better weather here. So, you know, I just think we're slightly deluded, as probably any country is, but we just don't have very much excuse for it, because we do have the good media, and if we could bother to read it, we'd probably realise more about the world.
So the reason is plainly about money and...
It's trying to get sell papers, you know, and...
Even if you are writing facts,
well, you see,
lies almost.
I don't think, you see, the interesting is I don't think it was a lie. Mm-hmm. It was, you can somehow get carried away with something, it's wishful thinking. Mm-hmm. You know, you think you've got a story, you think you've got a threat, it ties into the political viewpoint of your paper, it animates people, because clearly one of the things that animates people in the country, in Britain at the moment, is a concern of immigration. Mm-hmm. It's really a concern of people coming in and benefiting from... quite generous systems we have for supporting poor people, but of course it's fear mongering. I think journalists too often, use the sort of fears in people to stimulate sales of newspapers. I bet you that happens here, mm-hmm. and it happens in my country too. We're certainly not perfect in the press, mm-hmm. But I think there is greater discussion mm-hmm. about these things.
You were hosting Julian Assange for 2 years.
It came nearly to that. He was in the Frontline Club for a few months, mm-hmm. He went to jail for 2 weeks, and he needed a bail address. In Britain, we have the system whereby the judge can allow you to be out of prison while the whole court process is happening. And so, no one wanted to give him bail. I was in the court because I knew him because of the Frontline Club, and I thought the issues were so important. And I still do today, and I would still make the same decision today, that I offered bail, and he ended up staying with me on my farm for 13 months. And I think that, obviously you can imagine how interesting that was, because it was...
I can't.
it was very interesting. It was really fascinating. But also... I got on with him very well. I think... And there's something about the way that... society, you know, in Britain certainly, all turned on this guy, that I thought was not in our interests, not in the interests of the issues, which were very important, that related to what should and shouldn't be secret, what information does the public need to participate in a society. And all these issues are, of course, in great importance. But also, I saw something else. He was being very badly bullied. And what do I mean? The amount of money that was being spent to discredit the guy was so much more than the amount of the money that was clearly being spent to kind of, you know, consider the real issues at stake, and also to consider the impact of these documents and whether they were important to us and what the stories were there. And I didn't like the way it all got personalised.
What would be, in your view, the most positive benefit of WikiLeaks in very concrete, practical terms?
That's a very big question, actually, because I don't think we know yet. I think there's an increasing reliance on whistleblowers, because Edward Snowden has subsequently come along, mm-hmm. To feed the public with anything like the truth. It's quite possible in this part of the world to be envious of my country and America and set us up as beacons for freedom of speech and liberal democracy. But to do so is slightly testing it a little bit, because we're all on this scale. I brought up this scale thing again. America, if you look at, I'll give you an example. If you look at the Reporters Without Borders, there's a French organisation, NGO. They do a scale of which countries are where in relation to each other, mm-hmm. for press freedom. Mm-hmm. Of course, you know this. Well, America's around about 48, 49. Egypt, which is quite relevant at the moment, is 158. And there are 180 countries involved. Well, if you put America... at 48, round about 50. That's not at the top. It's not number one. Mm-hmm. And so what we've got to appreciate is, you know, the West hasn't got this right. We are not. We approach the world with our own interests, not simply to try to promote liberal democracy and human rights. I mean, there's a hypocrisy in the way we deliver this. And I think that There's also all the sort of things that happen in your country just happen a little bit less in ours. The idea that what's happening in Ukraine, the power of the oligarchs that comes from the East, is still capitalism, isn't it? Mm-hmm. It's, in America, you might argue, you might argue that capitalism has gone quite a long way. Ultimately, when these things all meet, aren't they all the same? Extremes of anything don't necessarily deliver what the public want.
Still, the situation raises quite an important question, especially from our perspective, Romanian one, and also not only Romanian, of course, about why we see in the last year so many leaks and conversation and talks about how feeble is the Western democracy and how many problems it got. Mm. But we don't see so many discussions about the Russian system or the Chinese system, and we don't see leaks about that. And here in Eastern Europe, we are tending to perceive all these events with WikiLeaks and Snowden and so on and so forth, that they are much more in the benefit of authoritarian system like Putin, even the Chinese system,
well,
of course.
I hope not, because I don't believe they are. Ultimately, I believe these things are in the public interest. The public will have no control in its society if it doesn't have the information to do so. You can't vote adequately if you don't know anything. And if you are truly misguided about important issues, society starts to make the wrong decisions. I can give you an example. Public relations. The amount of money being spent on public relations in my country, and I expect the same in yours, is so much greater than the amount trying to establish factual journalism, that the public is simply being poorly informed as a consequence. And the decisions it makes in terms of voting are going to be the wrong ones because they're not properly informed. And whether that's in my country or yours or in Russia, it's of equal importance to us. I think this is in the public good, and that's fundamental. But as to whether it promotes Russia or China or Ukraine or Romania over Britain, I don't think it does. I think actually it's very good, because I think there's a tendency for the West to be deeply hypocritical in the manner in which it kind of lectures everybody about how we're supposed to behave. And I think a little bit more honesty in that would be fine. For me, the biggest story of my lifetime as a journalist, the biggest story overwhelmingly, is about the manner in which post the Berlin Wall fell down, the West, instead of saying, right, the kind of threat, the whole Cold War threat's disappeared, now we can truly deliver and support, a liberal democracy and human rights, we haven't really done that. We've gone for our interests, and I think we've lost a massive opportunity to deliver a world, or improve a world, or make a world, a better place to live for all of us. Mm-hmm. I feel the West has terribly let us all down by focusing on narrow corporate, mainly corporate interests. I mean, the West sort of runs a kind of system of cartel capitalism. Mm-hmm. Well, that is on a scale to the oligarchs. These are still people who get benefits, but through these corporates they get benefits over the rest of us. The large businesses do better than the small businesses. Mm-hmm. These problems are linked. They differ by degree.
Probably you were yesterday in the evening at the first event of Frontline Bucharest, where at a certain moment it was a conversation about how the European Union helped Romania not to be much more similar to Ukraine. So from this side of the river, let's say like that, Western democracy is not perfect, that's true. There are also many problems there to be solved, but from our perspective, it's a matter of choice between very authoritarian regimes and a democracy with problems, but which is still working. So this kind of perception about guys like Snowden or Julian Assange, it's very pervasive here. How do you think that this can be, put together much more better explained to this kind of public as is in Eastern Europe?
I think there's a lot of work still to do in Eastern Europe to develop independent media that completely appreciates that it has a responsibility really only to the public, to the public interest. Mm-hmm. But it takes time, and there's a lot more to do. And I think that we in the West could have done better at supporting this. I mean, I think there's a tendency to pull out of places too soon and withdraw support. But also, we've got to set a better example, you know. And I think that's part of what the problem is.
How I would just go back to the personal story, your personal story. How was your family life affected by living in the same house with Julian Assange for 1 year and something?
Look, I mean, I'm not saying it's easy to share your house with anybody. I mean, look, if my brother came to stay after a couple of weeks, I'd start wanting to kick him out. But so, you know,
I suppose your brother is not Snowden, isn't it?
No. But so, of course, you know, it would be crazy to say that it was easy. And what made it difficult was the fact that there was a lot of pressure. A lot of pressure. Julian Assange was under an immense amount of pressure.
From whom?
Well, from all sorts of places, from the British media or elements of the British media. I mean, you know, I had rather senior journalists creeping through my gardens, you know, sticking their nose against my kitchen window, trying to sort of get an interview with him. I mean, it was quite a pressured and very busy time. But also, because Julian couldn't easily go and see other people, people had to come to him. So it wasn't just Julian. You know, we at one point had 20 people in our house. Mm-hmm. So it would be a lie to say that it was easy, but we knew what we were in for. We'd do it again. I think it was important. I think his interests now, I think, are very poorly served. I mean, there's a significant police operation involving roughly 50 police officers, outside the Ecuadorian embassy where he's been holed up for over a year, and at a vast expense to the taxpayer, it seems, and completely unnecessary, you know, for a man who is alleged to have done some minor sexual misdemeanor with the Swedes who won't come and interview him over in London. They insist he be sent there. I mean, you know, nobody else would get this sort of money spent on them on the basis of such a situation. So clearly there's something uniquely absurd about this. Mm-hmm. Clearly, he frightens powerful people. I don't think that's a bad thing, that powerful people are a little bit concerned.
Were you frightened by all this attention that you've got?
No, I was terrified by some of the journalistic attention. I remember one.
did your house got bugged, for example? I probably would know. Yeah,
look,
it is.
Look, you know that. I'm no security expert, so I can't tell you that I'm an expert at all in this sort of thing. However, I was advised by people that certain things were happening. Our mobile telephones apparently were being intercepted by people putting relay positions between the mobile phone antenna and us. And they do that apparently by sticking it in a vehicle, because the vehicle has a battery so it can support something. And we did establish that, because our phones used to get, when someone called, 000 as the calling in number, and apparently that's because it wasn't set up right. So more than that, my internet did slow down rather a lot. You know, we had an internet service at the house, and it wasn't very fast. And it sped up a little bit by the time they left. But I don't think anybody would be surprised by that. I wasn't surprised by it. We expected that sort of thing.
What's the future of all this? Because in a way, you didn't respond to one of my questions. What was the positive, beneficial, concrete fact after WikiLeaks and after what's happening also with Snowden?
I'll try and answer that. I mean, I'm absolutely certain that it's a kind of, I don't know, it's a bit of resistance. Power is corrupting, in a sense, the public are quite misinformed. Let me give you an example of the level of public disinformation. Somebody did a survey in Britain and established that most Brits thought that about 10,000 Iraqis being killed in the Iraq War, which my country was involved in. It was one of the aggressors, arguably. Well, the truth is probably more like 500,000. Now, that is quite a significant misunderstanding. So, you know, we went into a country, with the Americans, and 500,000 people got killed as a consequence of that. And we know how many Brits got killed, sort of roughly 400 or so. Now, that, I think, the misinformation, the misunderstanding, that is quite significant. And so, yes, You know, that has been corrected largely by WikiLeaks, but it's much more than that. I mean, the public benefit of this information, I think, is absolutely considerable. And it's not just, I mean, a lot of journalists were saying, well, hang on, we kind of knew that. But actually, when they wrote that in their newspapers, they balanced it with the other view. They never said this happened. They said, you know, that there's evidence that this happened, and then you get the balance, you know, the caution, and which basically leaves people suspicious but not certain. WikiLeaks told us what was going on in many areas with certainty, and I think that's incredibly valuable. Look, ultimately, information empowers the people.
So you think definitely that information provided by WikiLeaks reached the people?
Oh, yes. Look, not enough of it. And I think journalism could have done a lot better. And it would have done better not to focus so much on Assange, the personality. Because I tell you, there's nobody that you and I probably know that could survive that level of interest and level of criticism without falling short. You know, none of us are perfect. However, that's what they chose to do because it sells more newspapers. But what they should have been looking at more was the content. The problem with the content of these leaks is it requires some computer skills, some analysis skills. And journalists are now learning that we need these skills, but we don't all have them. I think that the public benefit outweighed any real security implications in the event. And people have said, oh, well, he put, you know, people's lives at risk. But they've never really come up with any evidence to support that. And so I don't think that's that credible.
One last question, because we are talking about independent journalists. Yeah. I know that Julian Assange got bailed out on a 300,000 euros, yeah?
Something like that.
Something like that. Yeah. It's a lot of money. Yeah. Where did he get them from?
He was, you know, a lot of people contributed money. They were less keen to provide somewhere for him to stay. I provided that, and I provided a certain amount of that money. In the end, I lost £12,000. Now, that's not a small amount of money. I would really like that back. But at the same time, you know, I don't feel that I should have been charged that. I don't feel people should have lost this money, but they did, and that's just life. You have to, you know, live with it. But you know, the principles and what we believe in is worth paying for. And if you're not prepared to put money up for these things, then, you know, what are you? You know, and so ultimately, yeah, some of his supporters lost money. But I don't think, you know, it wasn't Julian Assange that took that money. It was the court.
So we have to hope that you are not a Russian spy or the guys who just put money on this. Because, yeah it's a question of trust, of course, yeah?
Well, everything's trust. Everything's trust. But you can't expect to be trusted if you're going to, you know, keep too many secrets. You know, look, you guys used to have a pretty tough secret service here, the Securitate, and you know, and that was pretty uncompromising. You people know the risks of having overly powerful security services. We all know we need security services. It's not as if they don't look after us too. But you know, who controls them? They have to be controlled by politicians that we elect, and we have to know what they're doing, enough of what they're doing to be able to know that. But you know, my country, we all watch James Bond. We think these guys are really cool, so we don't really watch them.
We don't. Yeah.
No, you don't, and credit to you, because you're wiser than we are. The Germans don't. They have the Stasi. They're more suspicious. Yeah. We've never had anything like this that we feel is oppressive. And yet, when George Orwell's book of 1984 was situated in Britain, and you can read that book now, and you kind of think, well, hang on, wow, what if the oppressive regime in George Orwell's 1984 had the tools that the NSA and the British GCHQ had, you know, or have today? I mean, you know, it's extraordinary what can be done through our mobile phones and monitoring us. The internet, you know, we hope would free us, and perhaps it's freed some of us, and it's been a very good thing. But it's also the perfect device or perfect kind of network to control us, and we've got to guard against that. We can't just empower people to own it or weaponize it.